we are going to have today the topic nitrogen balance in fishes. Okay, so today we'll see how the nitrogenous how the nitrogenous compound get decomposed into the nitrogenous waste, how they get excreted outside the body, what are the biochemical reactions occurs, okay, to convert the food products into the nitrogenous waste product, okay, what are the different cycles involved, and then we'll see how they cause toxicity. Suppose if as we know, nitrogen is a component of protein, amino acid. Okay, you know, amino acids are the building block of proteins, and proteins constitute a major part of the biological system, whether it is in the term of the structure or whether it is in the terms of the function. So if nitrogen is an essential part of a vital molecules inside the body, then what is the need to excrete it out? Okay, so we will also see all those things today. So first we will see what does mean the nitrogen balance. Okay, so the nitrogen balance means the dietary intake of the nitrogen equal to the daily loss of the nitrogen through gills, urine, or in the form of fecal matter. Okay, so this is a simple formula. The nitrogen balance is equal to daily nitrogen intake is equal to daily nitrogen loss via GUF. G means the nitrogen loss through gills. Through gills, how the nitrogen will excrete from the body? In which form? Anyone can tell me? Anyone? बताइए.
अमोनिया के फॉर्म में.
अमोनिया के फॉर्म में. ओके. So, the nitrogen which is lost via the gill or in the form of, from the urine or in the fecal matter. Okay, so this is basically the nitrogen balance in the organism body. Okay, as we all know, actually, just tell me whether fishes are autotrophic or heterotrophic. Anyone? Fishes are autotrophic or heterotrophic?
Heterotrophic.
Heterotrophic means?
सेल्फ फूड खुद नहीं बनाएगा, दूसरे पे डिपेंडेंट रहेगा.
सेल्फ फूड खुद नहीं बनाए. ओके, सो फिशेस आर हेटरोट्रॉफिक. बिकॉज़ फिशेस आर हेटरोट्रॉफिक, दैट इज व्हाई देयर इज ऑलवेज अ इंबैलेंस बिटवीन द प्रोपोर्शन ऑफ द कंपोनेंट टेकन इन द फूड स्टफ वर्सेस द प्रोपोर्शन ऑफ द कंपोनेंट रिक्वायर्ड फॉर द ग्रोथ, मेंटेनेंस एंड रिप्रोडक्शन. ओके, बिकॉज इफ अ ऑटोट्रॉफिक ऑर्गेनिज्म, इट नो व्हाट इज हाउ मच particular food is required in the form of either carbohydrates or the lipids or the protein. But being a heterotrophic organism like human or the fishes or the animals particularly, so when they take the food stuff, okay, for energy, for growth and maintenance and reproduction, so there is an imbalance between the required components for the all the support of all the physiological process. Okay, suppose a particular animal need in one meal 100 grams of carbohydrates, around 70 grams of lipids, and somewhere 80 grams of proteins. Okay, but whenever you used to take any food stuff, it doesn't mean it always have a balance 100 gram carbohydrates, 70 gram lipids, and 80 grams of proteins. It's not like that. Okay, so there is always a, in most of the time, there is an imbalance of the component of the food stuff like carbohydrates, lipids, and protein versus the proportion we required for support of the physiological process. Okay, so what happen if we take the excess protein in the diet? What will happen? It will lead to the accumulation of the nitrogen inside the body. Why? Because it is more than our requirement. We need the protein, okay, to support for building blocks, for supporting the life of the organism or the cell. But if it if a diet is rich in protein, if the protein is taken more than the required, okay, if the protein is more in the food stuff, what will happen? It will lead to the accumulation of the excess nitrogen in the body as a form of ammonia or urea, okay? And how this ammonia and urea forms? It basically formed by the deamination and oxidation of amino acids. Deamination means removal of the amino group from the amino acid. So what happened? This excess nitrogen is accumulated in the form of ammonia and urea. So although the ammonia has a nitrogen component, so it is useful for the rebuilding of the amino acid and the proteins. But this form of nitrogen means nitrogen in the form of ammonia is toxic. Okay, and there is another form, urea. This is also toxic, but it is less toxic as compared to the nitrogen. We will see why urea is less toxic than ammonia in the next slide. Okay, so to maintain the body equilibrium or the osmotic equilibrium or the equilibrium of the solute solvent in terms of nitrogen, the waste nitrogen needs to be excreted out from the body either in the form of ammonia or urea. So the fishes excrete nitrogen in the form of? Fishes excrete nitrogen in the form of what?
Ammonia.
Ammonia. Cartilaginous fish.
Okay. Ammonia and urea both. If we talk about the teleost fishes, then they excrete the waste nitrogen in the form of ammonia, and cartilaginous fishes, they secrete nitrogenous waste in the form of urea. Okay. So the entire mechanism of the nitrogen balance, which involves several processes in which the waste nitrogen is produced and excreted. So in this today's class, we will see what are the different biological cycles or the biochemical cycles which takes place inside the animal's body, okay, to convert the excess nitrogen into the waste nitrogen like ammonia or urea, okay. So first question is, why we need to excrete the excess ammonia? Okay, the very first reason, because it is toxic. Okay, so why it is, another question is why it is toxic. Okay, so the anyone can tell me what is a law of mass action? Anyone? Law of mass action padha hai kisi ne?
Yes.
Anyone? Kuch yaad aa raha hai?
कुछ कंजर्व होता है उस टाइप का, कुछ
कंजर्व होता है. बेसिकली द लॉ ऑफ मास एक्शन इज द रेट ऑफ केमिकल रिएक्शन इज डायरेक्टली प्रोपोर्शनल टू द प्रोडक्ट कॉन्सेंट्रेशन. ओके, सो द रेट ऑफ द केमिकल रिएक्शन इज डायरेक्टली प्रोपोर्शनल टू द प्रोडक्ट कॉन्सेंट्रेशन. सो this ammonia have a tendency to pull or push the biomolecules from a particular reaction. Okay. If we see the example, there is a one, you know, the Krebs cycle. Krebs cycle is a TCA cycle, or a Krebs cycle is a central cycle of all the metabolic pathways which takes place inside the organism body, because whether it is the glycolysis or other cycles, okay, ultimately the acetyl coenzyme A directly goes into the Krebs cycle, or some of the intermediate in the form of oxaloacetate, they goes into the Krebs cycle. So what it did, ammonia used to basically push or pull the particular biochemical in a single in a reaction or in a cycle, in a biochemical cycles. Here the ammonia can potentially drive the glutamate dehydrogenase reaction towards glutamate. Means yani ki agar, if ammonia is in excess, what will happen? There is a reaction shifts toward the formation of the glutamate from alpha keto glutarate. So what will happen now means in this, inside the cell there is a less formation of the keto glutarate but more formation of the glutamate. So if there is a more formation of the glutamate, so there will be the depletion of the alpha keto glutarate. So if there is a depletion of the alpha keto glutarate, what will happen? There is a depletion of the Krebs cycle intermediate. And if there is a depletion of the Krebs cycle intermediate, if there is a decrease in the Krebs cycle conversion, then what will happen? It will affect all the physiological process, all the biochemical process which is occurring inside the cycle. That is why the ammonia is highly toxic. The another thing, the ammonia is actually a base. Okay, why? Why ammonia act as a base? कोई बताएगा मुझे?
Lone pair होता है उसमें.
Yes, because it has a lone pair of electrons. Okay, so when ammonia is produced in large quantity, okay, by the metabolism, it actually acts as a strong base. So what will happen? It acts as a strong base. So it depletes the proton from the blood and the cells. So if it depletes the proton, means it reduces the H-ion concentration. So if there is a reduction of the H-ion concentration inside the blood or in the cellular fluid, then what will happen? There will be the increase in the pH value. Means the pH of the cell and the blood will move toward the alkaline. Okay, so what happened? If the pH of the blood and the cellular cytosol or the cellular fluid reach or moves towards the alkaline pH, what will happen? It causes the destabilization of the macromolecules like proteins. Okay. It destabilizes the protein, so you can say that it basically denatures the protein and protein and other biomolecules, okay, like some of the carbohydrates and lipids molecules. So if and that actually ultimately affects the cell physiology and the reaction which is taking place inside the cell. Okay, and then the third one, if ammonia exists in a system as ammonium ion, okay, so if there is a high accumulation of the ammonia, then there will be the high concentration of ammonium ion also inside the body fluid. Then what will happen? It disrupts the normal transmembrane movement of other ions. Okay, so it substitute for this other positively charged ion like sodium and potassium ion in the ion transport pathway. So it actually disbalances the several machineries in the cell. A very good example is that if you know the central nervous system, in the central nervous system, what will happen? The information, the central nervous system controls the entire reaction of the entire of all the processes, biological processes, the behavior of an animal. Okay. So if there is an imbalance in the central nervous system, what will happen? The entire physiological process will collapse. Okay. But so what happened? This ammonium ion, it interferes with the ion transport process in the central nervous system. Because in the nervous system, the information is transferred from one cell to the another to the target organ simply by the movement of the ion across the synapse. Okay. So if there is an increase of the ammonium ion inside the body, what will happen? It interferes with the normal ion transport process of the nervous system. So it affects the physiology of the animal. Okay, so these are some of the reasons, okay, why ammonia is very toxic to the animal. Okay. Now, second one is why urea is toxic. As we know, it's toxic as compared to the ammonia. Okay, why? Because it exists in a single form. It exists as a non-charged molecule. So it does not exert the direct electrochemical interference or the acid base reaction or the gaseous effect. Okay, that is why it is less toxic as compared to the ammonia, but it doesn't mean it doesn't cause the toxic effect. Yes, it has a toxicity. Why? If there is a high concentration of the urea, it causes the denaturation of the proteins. Okay, denaturation means if you remember the very first semester class of fundamentals of biochemistry, we have taken the topic proteins, where we have studied about the protein folding. Okay, a protein is the primary structure of the protein is basically the peptide bonds between the amino acids, okay, are basically a polypeptide chain. Okay, but a polypeptide chain doesn't perform the function. Okay, a polypeptide chain needs to be folded into the right conformation to perform the function. Okay, so the any protein which perform the functions, because all most of the enzymes are proteins, and they actually catalyze all the biochemical reactions which occurs inside the cell. So what if there is a high concentration of the urea inside the cell? It basically destabilized the protein by simply denature the one second. It basically denature the protein. It distort the structure of the protein, the primary, the secondary, tertiary, and quaternary structure, which is important for the function of a particular protein. So that is why it is toxic. Okay. So if suppose there is a, if we say in the cartilaginous. In osmoregulation, some of the organisms, they accumulate the urea to the high level for osmoregulation. Okay, so if the urea is this much of toxic, then how an animal or the organism, okay, marine organism, can accumulate a very high level of urea for osmoregulation? So there is basically they adopt the counteracting solute strategy. Means they also have the high, they also store a very high concentration of the TMO. TMO is a trimethylamine oxide, which actually opposes the destabilizing effect of urea. So urea is causing the effect of destabilization of the protein. Now TMO is working against that. Okay, it opposing the stabilizing effect on the macromolecules. Okay, so this way the animals which accumulate the urea, high level of urea for osmoregulation, okay, they overcome the urea toxicity by accumulating the high concentration of the TMAO. Okay, so now here we'll see how this ammonia is formed and excreted in the fishes. Okay, whether in the teleosts as well as the cartilaginous fishes. Okay, so as I have told, the protein, okay, the main source of ammonia in the cell is basically the amino acid. And amino acids, they are the building blocks of protein. So when the intracellular protein is digested or get broken into the amino acid, okay, or the protein which take in, or the protein which animal takes in the, as a diet, in the dietary form. So in both the case, the digestion of the protein occurs and there is a breakage of the polypeptide bonds, peptide bonds, and now the amino acid. Then what happened? The carbon skeleton goes to the TCA cycle and the excess ammonia is excreted out when we talk about the teleost fishes or the bony fishes. Okay. So excess is excreted out from the body and some of the required ammonia is used for the biosynthesis of amino acids and the nucleotides and some of the biological amines. Okay. And but in case of elasmobranches, because elasmobranches doesn't excrete the ammonia, okay, they excrete the urea. So this ammonia is get converted into the urea by urea cycle. Okay, so this ammonia is get converted into the carbamyl phosphate. This carbamyl phosphate enters the urea cycle where it get converted into the urea, and this urea is basically the end product of the excretion, okay, and nitrogen excretion product. And this urea cycle is interlinked with the aspartate arginosuccinate shunt of the TCA cycle. So basically, the TCA cycle and the urea cycle is linked by a shuttle or the shunt, which is an aspartate arginosuccinate shunt of the acetic acid cycle. This detailed cycle we'll see in the next slide. So first here, we'll see how the production of the nitrogen waste from the breakdown of the amino acid. So first, we will take the amino acid from the ingested protein. Ingested protein means a protein which is taken as a food or diet, okay, or the cellular protein, okay, means there is regularly a tearing of the or the breakdown of the cellular protein also. So what happened, they get broken down into the individual amino acid, okay, inside the liver. This amino acid is now converted into the, so this amino group of this amino acid is get transferred to the glutamate. Okay, so alpha-ketoglutarate is converted into the glutamate, and now this amino acid is become keto acid. Now this glutamate is again get converted into the alpha-ketoglutarate, and it releases the ammonia, which can be excreted in the form of either ammonia, urea, or uric acid. Okay, so this glutamate is comes in this process from several other biological processes also. Like the alanine of the muscle, okay, it reacts with the alpha ketoglutarate and then it transfers the ammonia to the glutamate and gets converted into the pyruvate. Even the glutamine also transfers the also release the ammonia and it gets converted into the glutamate, but further release the ammonia, okay. So the glutamine from the muscle or the other tissue also release the ammonia in the liver. Then there is another cycle in the muscle cells which takes place. This is in the liver cell, and now this is in the muscle cell. Muscle cell, what happened? This step is same in both the liver and the muscle cell. The amino acid is gets converted into the alpha keto acid, and now the amino group of this amino acid is now transferred to the glutamate. Now this glutamate, when again converting into the alpha keto glutarate, it transfers the glutamate to the aspartate. Okay, and then this aspartate is get converted into the adenosyl succinate, and this adenosyl succinate get broken down into the adenosine monophosphate and fumarate. And this adenosine monophosphate, in the presence of AMP deaminase, it deaminase means enzyme which cause the release of the ammonia. So ammonia gets released, and there is a formation of the IMP, inosine monophosphate. So these are the two places where the ammonia forms from the breakdown of the protein. Okay, so here we'll see how ammonia pathway occurs in the hepatic cells of the teleost. So here is the glutamine from the extrahepatic tissue, means the glutamine from tissue other than liver. Okay, so it comes inside the mitochondria of the liver. Okay, in the form of glutamine, then glutamine is convert glutamine into the glutamate, and this glutamate is again release the ammonia and get converted into the alpha ketoglutarate. Okay, so this is how it is, ammonia is produced in the hepatic cell of the teleost. Now, how this is the ammonia? This is the same which I have discussed in this slide. Okay, it was. I discussed together here in the liver cell and here in the muscle cells, and here now this is basically on separate slides, the liver cell, and now it is in the muscle cell via the protein nucleotide cycle in the muscle. So here the oxaloacetate is converted into the aspartate. It is then formed as an adenosyl succinate, which is again broken down into the AMP and fumarate, and at the end the release of the ammonia by the action of the AMP deaminase. Okay, so this was the cycle which is operational in the teleost fishes or the bony fishes. Now we have, as we know, the cartilaginous fishes, they excrete the ammonia in the form of urea, which is less toxic form. Okay, so this is the pathway of the urea production. So basically there is a three cycle. These are three processes actually altogether. Occurs, the urea cycle is occurs in the cytosol. The urea cycle is a cycle which occurs in two compartments of the cell. Okay, the one reaction takes place inside the matrix of the mitochondria, and rest of the reactions occurs inside the cytosol. Even some of the intermediate also of the urea cycle, it also comes, which also forms in the mitochondrial matrix, and then later it joins the urea cycle in the cytosol. So here first we see the glutamine. The glutamine is get converted into the glutamate, which causes the release of the ammonium ion. Okay, so what happened? This ammonium ion, in the presence of ATP and carbonic ion, what it did, carbonic acid, what it did, it basically forms the carbamyl phosphate. Okay, now this carbamyl phosphate joins with the ornithine and it forms the citrulline. Now this citrulline comes inside the cytosol from the mitochondrial matrix. So here in the mitochondria, in the cytosol, the citrulline is get converted into the arginosuccinate, okay, by an intermediate which is known as the citronyl AMP intermediate. So when citrulline is converted into the arginosuccinate, okay, even this reaction also required the aspartate, and this aspartate come from the reaction which occurs inside the mitochondrial matrix, where oxaloacetate is get converted into the aspartate. This aspartate comes here and it joins the urea cycle, where the formation of the citrulline to the arginosuccinate. Then this arginosuccinate is converted into the arginine, which causes the release of the fumarate. Okay. Now when this arginine is converted into the ornithine, now the urea is released. Now this urea is excreted from the body of the elasmobranch in the form of nitrogenous waste. Okay, so basically the urea cycle is a cycle which operates in two separate compartments. Most of the reactions occur inside the cytosol, but one, the conversion, that is the ornithine to the citrulline, is in mitochondrial matrix, because the formation of the carbamyl from ammonia takes place inside the mitochondrial
matrix. वैसे लिखता है कोई और बात ना
से
नहीं
दाई भाई कौन है ओके अफसर अभी अच्छा ऑफ किया ओके सो नाउ the transport of ammonia from plasma to water. Okay, so as I have told, the ammonia or urea, they are basically formed inside the body. Now it has to be get out from the organism body. So diffuse, because it is very soluble. Ammonia is soluble in aqueous medium. So it's basically transported through the blood. Okay, and from the gill surface, it get diffuses. Okay, it basically its diffusion always takes place along the concentration gradient. The direct diffusion occurs from blood to the water. Okay, whether it is present in the form of ammonia or it is present in the form of ammonium ion. Okay, and it also get means get excreted out from the body through the gill cells. By one of the functional channel or the transporter, which is known as a sodium ammonium exchange channel, which is present on the gill cells. So basically, majority of the ammonia basically directly diffuse from blood to the water. Okay, when blood the blood which have the excess ammonia, it comes on the surface through the gills, and then it simply get directly diffuses into the surrounding water, and there are some channels also. The transport channels which helps in the transportation or excretion of the excess ammonia outside the body. Now the transportation of the urea. Okay, so urea transportation is basically occurs with the help of the urea transporter, basically a transmembrane transporter protein which is present on the membrane of the liver cell, hepatocytes, on the membrane of the red blood cells and the gill cells. So with the help of the urea transporter or the transporter protein, urea get excreted from this tissue, okay, and to the blood, and from blood it gets diffused to the outer, it's get released to the outer environment. Okay, so this is about today's